Hi again, everybody, moms and dads, boys and girls, you are in the chatter zone. This is episode
121.
And we're going to begin with Art Gilloon and Augustine Payne right after we say, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Remember,
O most gracious Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone who fled to thy protection, implored thy help, or sought thy intercession, was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly unto thee, O Virgin of virgins, my Mother. To thee I come, before thee I stand, sinful and sorrowful. O Mother of the Word incarnate, despise not my petitions, but in thy mercy hear and answer me.
Amen. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This is the Chatter episode 121. We are brought to you by
Hot Works
over on Holiday Drive.
Yes, so go see your friends at Hot Works.
Pick up an L while you're over there. They have an extra L.
They do have an extra L
over
there.
On Holiday Drive. So Art Gilloon is in the house with Augustine Payne. And Colleen, the listeners must have complained to the producers because I always say, Art, when were you over here last? So the producers gave us, did you see the chatter episodes?
Yeah.
Art, do you realize how many times you've been on the chatter?
More than once.
Episode 30 was your first time. I don't have the exact date. Episode 30. We begged for 29 times. He finally came on episode 30.
Yeah.
Episode 43, Art Gilloon was back in the house, 13 episodes. And then he was back-to-back in episode 48 and 49.
And then I started bringing Augustine Payne, our tremendous executive director at Dubuque County Right to Life, and people started listening.
Episode 77, that's what, four
Five.
Times?
Five.
One, two, three, four, five. And then you were episode 102 with where's our sidekick, Grace Van Patten?
Oh, yeah, where's Grace?
You have to ask us.
Yeah, I'll have to bring her next time.
Yeah.
I just want to inform
Six
our listeners,
times.
these are unreimbursed appearances, by the way. There's no fees associated with these appearances.
We sent him in W-9, didn't we?
We did. And a couple of invoices. So far, nothing in the house. Hey, Gus, plug the life dinner. Will you tell us what's going on this year, some different things?
Make sure your listeners know who Gus is.
Yeah, so I'm the executive director of Dubuque County Right to Life, and every year we have our annual life dinner. And this year will be on a Thursday, April 4th. It's a little bit earlier than normal, but it's normally around the time of Easter, which this year, Easter is earlier than typical. And so Thursday, April 4th, down at the Grand River Center, we normally have about 450, 500 people attend, and we normally bring in a keynote speaker. This year's keynote speaker is Mark Houck. He is some of your listeners might recognize his name from being in the national news last, was it 2 years ago now, ready? 2 or 3 years ago, where
time flies when you're in prison,
right? Mm-hmm. When he was arrested by the FBI with several armed agents for protecting his son outside of an abortion clinic from a hostile abortion clinic escort. So the Biden administration wanted to make him an example and intimidate pro-lifers across the country about praying outside of an abortion clinic and offering real help to moms in need.
Mm-hmm.
And so he went through they arrested him, and that was after even offering a voluntary showing up for court. And so it definitely was, there's lots of evidence to support the fact that it was an act of intimidation. But yeah, we get the honor of having him here in Iowa on April 4th, and we'll hear probably more about his story and inspiration to be involved in the pro-life movement.
How much are the tickets, Gus?
Yeah, so the dinner's underwritten by sponsors and supporters alike, and so there's no cost to attend, so therefore we try to get as many people as possible to hear his great story.
But even though there's no cost to attend, they have to RSVP, right?
Correct, yes. Thank you. Yeah, they have to RSVP. They can RSVP by contacting our office at 563-556-5960. Again, that's 563-556-5960. Or they can email us at dcrtl@dcrtl.org. And if you're not in a position to write down that contact information, it's all on our website. And just reach out to our office and let us know that you're coming.
Mm-hmm.
One of the best things about that night, besides you guys always have a really good speaker, but I just love getting together with a lot of like-minded people in a big room. And sometimes that's the shot in the arm that you need to keep going, right?
Yeah.
And I think, was it last year that you had so many young people on stage? Or was it the year before? Like Grace spoke and...
Yeah, last year was Grace. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it's amazing. Just talk about time flying. Just last year, we're just getting introduced to her life story, and now she's actively involved in our organization. So
we're excited.
Gus, tell them what you're doing this year for people who can't attend in person.
Yeah, thank you. So this year, we're going to be live streaming it.
Wow.
So those who can't attend in person can watch it on our Facebook page or on our YouTube page.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Very nice.
The battle goes on, Art.
Yes. Hi, Tom.
Good to see you.
Good to be seen. For your listeners that might not remember me, even though you've had me on the program many times, I'm in my 46th year of practicing
law. They're calling in. They're saying it's the chatter starring Art Gilloon.
Yeah, right. I'm in my 46th year of practicing law, and I've made it part of my life's work in the law to be involved in the pro-life movement. And I know we're going to be talking a lot about court stuff and legislative stuff, and I just remind our listeners that the excellent newsletter that Gus and his staff put together for Dubuque County Right to Life is now out, and we do a pro-life court and legislative update there that will bring people up to date on news around Iowa, other states, and the world. So we'll hit some things today, but if they want to see that, they can pick up a copy at our office, call, and we'll email it or mail it, and it's on our website too, isn't it, Gus?
We are not updating that because we're working on updating our new website.
Okay.
So once we get our new website launched, all those will be up.
But if they want an email, we
what
can...
What a slave driver he is.
We can certainly do that.
Put up a new website.
Yeah.
So, you want to start?
I'm afraid to open this can of worms. It's been 20-some weeks since you've been over here. We said that the 2024 year was going to have crazy stuff, and... That's an understatement, I think. Are we going to open with Alabama?
No, we're going to open with some Iowa.
I can't even guess. Huh?
Iowa and local news.
Okay, let's go there.
Everyone knows about Mary's Inn here in Dubuque, which is the only maternity home in northeast Iowa. And our own Colleen Pasnick here is the executive director. And
Big Mama.
Had some issues last fall buying a house that wanted to buy, and some zoning issues got in the way. Today... everyone would be happy to know that a bill to protect maternity homes from zoning regulations and restrictions that would keep them from a residential neighborhood was passed in the House, the Iowa House, went over to the Senate. This last Wednesday, there was a subcommittee hearing, the local government committee of the Iowa Senate. It passed out of there. Today, it was heard at 2 p.m. this afternoon in the full committee of the local government committee, and it passed there. So all's necessary for its passage is... for the Iowa Senate to consider its House File 2276. And assuming it has no amendments, the Senate hopefully will pass it. The Republican-controlled legislature is pro-life, and we believe this is legislation needed around the state to protect maternity homes.
So what exactly does this legislation do then?
And simply put, it adds maternity homes to the list of elder homes and homes for the disabled who are going to be treated as families, even though the individuals living there are usually not related by blood.
Mm-hmm.
They're treated as families for residential living purposes.
Sure.
And thus, for zoning regulations, you can't zone out a family from a residential neighborhood.
Which happened in Dubuque.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And it just goes along with the idea that, you know, we need to accept and welcome those. And some need protection to have that ability to go live where you want as a family in a residence in a neighborhood and not be restricted to an office setting or a commercial setting or out somewhere out by yourself, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And in its simplest form, why would anyone be afraid of some babies and pregnant moms living next door?
Frightening.
Yeah.
Just frightening.
Yeah. So...
So let's give a timestamp. We're recording Monday, March 11th, and you just put a couple of... dates coming up when it's in the Iowa Senate.
Yeah, and so it has until the end of the legislative session to be considered and passed, which is usually, I want to say, late April. But they can go on depending on what they're considering. They can extend it.
So do we need to encourage people to contact their senators?
I would say so, yeah. Senator Kerry Kelker is from this area, and Senator Pam Yoakum is from this area.
And what's the status of the House?
It passed the House.
So
House Shannon Lundgren introduced it in the House.
From out here in Piazza?
Yes. So it's, you know, most bills have to be passed in one chamber or the other, start in the House, come to the Senate. So it's Senate File 2276, and if you want to contact your senators and say, please support this bill,
and
I think that'd be great.
Governor Reynolds has given any indication?
Sure, she'll sign it.
She'll sign it.
If it comes out of the legislature, she'll sign it.
So we got to get it out of Senate committee to the Senate floor. And
it's out of Senate committee, eligible. It has to be placed on the Senate calendar, and I think the senator in charge is Jack Whitfer. I want to say W-H-I-T-V-E-R. I think it's V-E-R. And he's been a good pro-life leader in the Iowa Senate. So
what's his zip code?
I don't know.
Okay.
I think he's from the Des Moines area, but I'm not sure. Okay. But if you go on the Iowa Legislature website, and you'll find all this information in an email for Senator Whitfer.
And it's the same file number in the Senate as it was in the House?
Yes.
HF2276.
Yeah, House File 2276. That's what they're calling it even in the Senate.
Okay. Got it.
So
good. Thank you.
So that's the first good news. It's nice to have some good news.
All right.
Secondly, just to update our listeners, the heartbeat law, which they may recall was passed in a single day session for the second time, maybe the third time in the Iowa legislature last July, is still on the docket for the Iowa Supreme Court. I think final briefing is due early April. If they schedule for oral arguments, that would come in late April, early May. And then hopefully we'd have a decision from the Iowa Supreme Court before they end their work this June.
Why? Give us some background. Why the heartbeat law? Which version of the heartbeat law is this?
It's the same version that was passed before. It's a heartbeat law generally recognizing that the human heart in the gestational form, if you will, is generally detectable at about 6 weeks, but individuals can vary.
Sure.
So it requires an abdominal ultrasound be performed by a physician on a pregnant woman who's considering abortion, that she be told the approximate gestational age of her unborn child. They have to wait at least 24 hours. She's given information, I believe, on alternatives and counseling available. And then hopefully after, you know, for many women, and I know Colleen has firsthand experience with this, and clients I've had over the years, hearing their child's heartbeat makes a difference.
Mm-hmm.
It's a game changer.
Yeah,
yep,
it makes,
sure
it makes a difference. It brings the reality of the humanness of their child.
No longer right? A blob of tissue.
Right. You know, and we have a generation or two now that's grown up seeing ultrasound pictures at various stages of human development, and they're on the refrigerator, and the kids in school mm-hmm. know what the science, you know, we get this big saying, follow the science. Well, if we follow the science of unborn human life, you know, we'd always err on the side of finding that it's human life from conception to natural death
mm-hmm.
and find ways that would support women, which we're trying to do, to give them, and as Gus says frequently, make abortion unthinkable. That's the educational task of Dubuque County Right to Life.
So we just talked about the Mary Zinn bill and how we want to contact our senators. With this heartbeat bill in the Supreme Court, do people contact their Supreme Court justices? I've never heard of anybody doing that.
No, there's the
really shouldn't do that, should you?
There's no lobbying of the Supreme Court, and the justices can't actually talk about it. What we as individuals need to rely on is that the adversaries in this proceeding will exhaustively and comprehensively brief the court on all aspects of this law and try to get and you know, argue the righteousness of the pro-life cause before the justices and give them all the information they need to come down on the idea that this law should be upheld. So that if that happens, then Iowa's current 20-week law would be nullified and supplanted by this new 6-week or heartbeat law, as they call it for short.
Well, maybe we can't call our Supreme Court justices, but we can certainly call on heaven
yeah.
that
mm-hmm.
the right decision would be made, that the decision that protects life would be made.
Yeah, but the Emma Goldman Abortion Clinic in Iowa City advertises that they do abortions up to 19 weeks and 6 days, because it's a 20-week. So imagine how imprecise that is in reality. And here, if we have a six-week heartbeat bill passed, it becomes law. I'm sure their advertising will be, well, we'll kill babies up to 5 weeks and 6 days.
Yeah. So this is before the Iowa Supreme Court.
Iowa Supreme Court.
But not for the first time. Is that true?
No, this is the...
Give that background again in case they...
Tom, to be honest with you, it's just too long. It's just
not even
literally,
the cliff notes?
Well, the cliff notes are, it got passed, went up the Iowa Supreme Court, got rejected. I'm doing this from memory, but then the Iowa Supreme Court made a ruling saying that the Iowa Constitution has no constitutional right to abortion. A week or so later, or a month later, the United States Supreme Court came down with a Dobbs decision saying the same thing. So then they put the original heartbeat law in front of the Iowa Supreme Court, and they made this terrible decision that said, well, the law you passed was kind of a fake law because you passed it when Roe v. Wade was still the law of the land. So now you have to pass a new one.
Because
so that's what they did last July in a single-day session.
Right.
So now it's the same one they rejected before, but now it's back to them in the context. It's post-Dobbs and post-Iowa's decision that mirrored Dobbs.
And after the Roe fell, it went back to the states, the decision?
Well, not necessarily. What all Dobbs said was that the Roe v. Wade decision that found a constitutional, United States constitutional right to abortion was wrong. They didn't say that this restricts future legislation to the states or to the feds. So the federal government, make no mistake, it's in front of the states, and the federal government, through your U.S. Congress people and senators and a president, could pass a national pro-abortion law. Make no mistake.
Yeah.
So it's very important, you know, if one party controls the House and the Senate of the United States and the presidency, they could pass a federal law allowing abortion up to moment of birth.
So we're not sitting back, resting on our laurels here and just looking at the state level. So that's good to know about the federal.
It's with the people, but it's with the people. And now all these states are acting because they can act, because there's no federal law in place now that would stop a state law. That's why you have laws that have protective laws for the unborn in many states, and there's laws that allow the killing of the unborn in lots of other states.
So if our state says heartbeat law passes, that abortions in Iowa are not legal after 6 weeks, after the heartbeat's detected, can they say, regardless of what the federal courts or the federal does?
Normally, a federal law is going to supersede a state law on the same subject. Mm. So it's
we got to talk about that on the other side of the break, Art. This is an election year, 2024. We got to talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
You're listening to Art Gilloon, Augustine Payne from Dubuque County Right to Life on The Chatter, episode 121. We'll be back right after these announcements. We're back in the studios with Art Gilloon. Colleen, we've got Augustine Payne here going on. I wanted to talk about this Iowa bill for the maternity homes. I think twice you slid it by here. You called it the Mary's Inn Maternity Bill. Is that what we're calling it down
no,
in Des Moines? Or just Dubuque? Or just here?
What happened to Mary's Inn here in Dubuque was the impetus for Shannon Lundgren sponsoring the bill.
Right.
As we talk here, Tom, I will I'll get the exact title, or maybe somebody can look
it
up here.
I don't know. It works for me.
If you Google House File 2276, it should come up.
It just says a bill for an act relating to the zoning of maternity groups homes, but I don't see where a name would be on it other than
it's rather impersonal. I like the way that was going.
Tom, I think you just wanted to ask me a question you knew I didn't know the answer to.
There's a first. Took 8 episodes to get that to go. Hey, speaking of another one, did anybody catch, or was it only me, the country in Europe, France, passed, I believe unanimously in the Parliament. Did you catch this, Gus?
It wasn't unanimous, but
was
it
was no?
really close to being unanimous.
They've enshrined as a constitutional right to abortion in France.
No. Mm-hmm. The eldest daughter of the church.
Did you? Not unanimous, I think, but it was pretty close, Gus.
I think there was a couple of dissenters.
Oh, my goodness. Lord have mercy.
Yeah.
If this isn't a sign, first country in the world to constitutionally grant a right to abortion, the eldest daughter in the church, France. St. Joan of Arc.
Oh, pray for us, right?
Pray for us.
I hope that our government doesn't get any ideas from that, which it probably will.
Well, the vote was in the French Parliament was 780 in favor and 72 against.
Wow.
They needed a 3/5 majority, and of course, Macron was in favor of it. And it basically states there's a guaranteed freedom to abortion in France.
Which is expanding abortion in France. Because prior to that, France was, I think, like at 13 weeks or 12 weeks. Mm-hmm. So they're expanding it to basically be up until birth.
What's next, Gus? What's next? If you can go up to birth.
Well, it'll probably be a 30 days afterwards because, mm-hmm. in all honesty, there are conditions that they can't detect until after birth.
Mm-hmm.
And most of the people
conditions, meaning birth defects, and birth they're going to be eugenics now?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I could see that being next.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think Peter Singer, who is a moral theologian, or he's some guy at Princeton, philosopher, he's arguing for up to a year after birth, you can still decide to have that abortion. Yeah.
Wow. And he's made that argument a long time.
Yeah, a long time.
Because his belief in abortion is based on the fact that they don't have self-awareness in the womb. And so if you were to follow that train of thought, we don't get self-awareness as human beings until some would say as early as 6 months, but most likely a year or two, a year and a half.
Can't you see, though, the evil door that opens? I mean, what about someone who's in a car accident and now suddenly they're not self-aware?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Can you just see how it opens the door to killing anybody that we find inconvenient?
Yeah.
Pure unadulterated evil. Let's say, should we talk about Alabama?
Let's talk about Alabama.
And you looked at me and said, Tom, do you have the whole story? And I got to admit, I'm only getting it third hand from whatever news outlet. What's the real story in
Tell
Alabama?
Us the story.
Well, let's go to the end, and then we'll back up over it. The end was in mid-February, the Alabama Supreme Court came out down with a decision that found Alabama's wrongful death statute, which applies to human beings, was applicable to frozen embryos who had been destroyed in an unfortunate accident, if you will, in a cryogenic laboratory. Let me offer you, you don't get these facts from what you read in the paper on the internet, so I can give you the background. So what that meant was two or four couples who had sued the cryogenic lab for the following facts. Here's the facts alleged. There hasn't been a trial yet. The parents have frozen embryos
that are left over from the in vitro
process
I
have.
Think so that everyone, in case they're not familiar with IVF, is in vitro fertilization. And typically, if a couple goes through that process, they fertilize more people than they are going to implant. So they might fertilize up to 6 eggs or so, which then become people at fertilization. They might only implant one or two.
Embryonic people.
Yep. So then what do you do with these leftover embryos that you may want to implant down the road? So they freeze them.
Mm-hmm. Which was what? Cryogenic.
Cryogenics. Here's from the brief I printed out today in this case that the Alabama Medical Association filed.
Okay.
On behalf of the cryogenic lab that had, through their negligence, had destroyed these children. So they say some embryo, in vitro basically means outside of the womb. So it says IVF is only about 50% successful, meaning nearly half of the implanted embryos will not result in a successful pregnancy. Further, cryogenic freezing and de-thawing processes, even when done perfectly, may damage the embryos such that they are no longer suitable for implantation. This is the doctors.
Mm-hmm.
The IVF process frequently involves the discarding, I love that word,
Sure.
As opposed to the death, the destruction. Discarding of unused cryogenically destroyed embryos. It is common for healthy in vitro embryos to remain in cryogenic storage after a couple has completed all desired treatments. A couple who has utilized IVF may not use all of their, they might not use all of their cryopreserved embryos for numerous reasons, health, death, divorce, etc. And they write, in such circumstances, the unused cryogenic preserved embryos are typically discarded or donated. Now note this. Embryos are not usually stored in perpetuity due to the high cost of cryogenic storage and limited storage capacity. And the people that sued here, the couples that sued, acknowledged that in the process of agreeing to IVF treatment, they understood that at some point their cryogenically preserved embryos would be discarded if they weren't used. So what happened here was this cryogenic storage facility called the Center for Reproductive Medicine and Mobile Infirmary Association, DBA Mobile Infirmary Medical Center, was, they were linked. And a patient in the connected hospital wandered over into the cryogenic lab through an unsecured door, opened a drawer or some sort of file cabinet or storage where these human beings are frozen, embryonic human beings.
Wow.
Took them out. They're frozen, of course, in sub-zero, like dry ice type temperatures. When this person got them in their hands burned, of course, from the freezing
sure.
test tubes or whatever it was, and they dropped them, killed them. So the parents here, or the couples, let's see here. I think there's two or four of them. Anyway, they sued the cryogenic lab saying that you have destroyed our babies, in essence, and we want money. Mm-hmm. Your negligence destroyed our embryos, and we want money. In the trial court, the judge ruled that Alabama's wrongful death statute, which allows people to sue if your child gets killed by a drunk driver and so forth, did not apply to embryos because they weren't in utero. They're not in a mom. The Alabama Supreme Court said, we disagree. Part of the reason they disagreed, I mentioned in our pro-life and legislative update in the newsletter, is they said this. This is the Alabama Supreme Court. And now the Alabama Supreme Court, by the way, made a whole court ruling, and then that some of the justices wrote their own opinions, but they say this. Before analyzing the party's disagreement about the scope of the wrongful death of a minor act, we'd like to explain the background points of agreement. Now listen to this. So these folks are saying, these are children. The doctors and the Center for Reproductive Rights is saying, well, whatever they are, you can't sue us because they're not covered by the wrongful death statute. So the court notes, all parties to these cases, like all members of the court, meaning the Supreme Court justices of Alabama, agree that an unborn child is a genetically unique human being whose life begins at fertilization and ends in death. The parties further agree that an unborn child usually qualifies as a human life, human being, or person. And those words are used in the ordinary conversation and in the text of Alabama's wrongful death statute.
Wow.
So
that's huge.
So the court said to everybody, okay, you're all here. We understand what the arguments are, but just understand, you all agree, right, that these embryos are basically unborn human beings. The parents have to agree to that because if they aren't, they won't win. Because unless they're unborn human beings, they can't qualify under the wrongful death.
They can't stand, yeah.
So when the Alabama Supreme Court came out and they said, for purposes of our wrongful death statute, we're going to treat, in this specific case, these embryos that were destroyed as qualifying the parents to sue under the wrongful death statute. Now, that means the case goes back to the district court for a trial on what happened with the witnesses and damages, and experts will come on and say this is worth $1 million or whatever it might be.
Alabama State District Court.
Alabama State Court. Now, what happened after that was the pro-aborts grabbed on to the concept that all of us are sympathetic to folks that can't have children, and all of us know people who have gone through IVF, and they're using this decision and those who support it to foster the idea that we will stop all this kind of, that this Alabama decision stopped all that. Alabama decision didn't stop anything. The IVF folks in Alabama kind of quit doing things till the dust settles. But it does force the people who discuss these issues, including pro-life and pro-abortion people, to focus on the idea that if this is a human being, and this question might be asked of the plaintiffs in this case, the people who had these embryos, during the IVF process, which discards these embryos, the folks going through IVF treat the embryos as property, not mm-hmm. as human beings. But once they were destroyed, then they said, well, you destroyed our human beings. And some would ask, I make no judgment on this program right now, but some would ask, can you have it both ways? Can you rationally have it both ways? Can you rationally say, these are mine, that I agree eventually they're going to be destroyed, we'll destroy some of in the process,
mm-hmm.
and every physician and person who I've talked to says as part of the process, you agree that if we implant 6 or 7 embryos and 6 or 7 take, and you can't have 6 or 7 babies, we're going to have to selectively abort 3 or 4 or 5 of those.
That's part of the upfront agreement.
That's part of the upfront agreement. And as the Alabama Supreme Court pointed out, they agree ahead of time that they know at some point they're going to get a bill from the cryogenic lab or a statement saying, we can't keep these any longer. We don't have the facility. We got newer ones coming in. So you either find somewhere else or we're going to destroy them. So it's the dichotomy is, on the one hand, we want people to have babies. On the other hand, should the pro-life movement really countenance and approve of a method that destroys human beings in the process, freezes human beings in the process? And I'll just end and we can talk about it. What this shows is science in this process and many others, cloning and otherwise, got way ahead of the law. Scientists just charge on. If we can do it, we're going to do it. And here, for years and years, decades, we've had IVF treatment going on, producing and freezing human beings with little or no legislation to say, these are the rules. And this is what happens when there's no rules. We have thousands of frozen human beings all around the country, presumably owned by other human beings.
How long has IVF been going on, Colleen?
Louise Brown, the first test tube baby was 1978. So since 78. But I just looked up while Art was talking, and according to Loma Linda University Center for Fertility and IVF, there are 600,000 frozen babies in these cryogenic labs. 600,000.
That's current, dare I say, inventory?
Underestimate. I think they estimated that it can be even in the millions.
Goodness.
You know, two things I would offer our listeners. One is Lila Rose, who may be familiar with some of the listeners. If they aren't, just Google Lila Rose, L-I-L-A Rose, R-O-S-E, is a pro-life author and writer and has a website and so forth. And she put out a statement saying this: infertility can be an incredibly painful burden and is increasingly common, but the solution cannot be to deny legal protections to human embryos or allow them to be frozen or killed at the will of America's IVF industry. That's a real simple statement of what's at stake here. Similarly, the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops on February 28, 2024, since we're a Catholic radio station and Catholics will care, there is already been proposed the Access to Family Building Act, Senate File 3612, in the federal legislature that purports to legalize all of this, okay? And the bishops acknowledge that the often painful, I'm reading from this letter, written to the United States Senate. The often painful experience of infertility is a challenge facing an increasing number of families. As pastors, we grieve with many couples bearing this cross and seek to be part of a community that accompanies them in a way that helps them to flourish in love. We can understand the profound desire that motivates some of those couples to go to great lengths to have children, and we support morally licit means of doing so. And then they go on to say, we can't, and it's the old Catholic dogma, you can't use an illicit, immoral, deadly means to obtain a good end. You can't.
Right. The ends does not justify the means.
Right. And what they suggest is, let's subsidize and foment and pursue research into infertility as a method, as addressing those concerns on the part of infertile couples, but let's not kill generations of children along the way. And some people won't like to hear that, but that has to be the consistent pro-life position.
Painful issue. We're out of time in segment 2 of episode 121. We're going to be right back here on the chatter after these announcements. Back, this is The Chatter, episode 121. We are brought to you by Hot Works on Holiday Drive here in Dubuque. If you're listening in Pennsylvania, you don't know Hot Works.
And you probably can't get there in half
from
an
there,
hour.
From there.
Can't get there from here.
What a show, Colleen.
My goodness, so much good information. One of the things we were talking about IVF, in vitro fertilization, this last segment. But I know, and I'm sure all of you know, people who have conceived children this way, and what do we say to them, to the parents, to the children? What do we say to them? What do you think, Gus?
Yeah, so I think what is the stigma that's out there is that we hate them. Mm. And I think we have to work extra hard to make it known that we see these people as having an equal right to life, the same as you and I. Mm-hmm. Their life matters. We don't go around asking people how they've been conceived, mm-hmm. to determine their worth. I think it goes to the same, mm-hmm. issue with rape and, mm-hmm. out of wedlock, whatever traumatic circumstances that, mm-hmm. have come, that people come into existence by, we don't determine their worth by that.
That's right. And I think one of the reasons so many pro-lifers get upset about IVF is because we do see the value in those children.
Yeah.
Right? We don't think they're second-class citizens or not worthy of any. We do realize the value of those children.
And I think we view our mission at Dubuque County Right to Life, and it has always been an educational one. So we're there to give facts, to tell where, for example, the bishops stand, where others stand. We're not an organization that judges people. Anything I just said is not meant to say these people are bad people. Have great sympathy for them. I have friends. I know people that have gone through IVF. On the other hand,
we're talking process, right?
The process. And on the other hand, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to countenance everything that occurs in those situations. Our job is to educate those people and the people who might consider IVF about what the law is, about what the Catholic Church and other organizations would say, and what a consistent pro-life view might be or should be. And then they can make their own decision. I'm not here to say someone is destined for, you know, a bad ending if they,
right.
go. That's not our role.
But do you think the awareness is there? Do you think the reality, the comprehension happens on the subject of these extra embryonic human beings that are frozen?
Well, I think what is happening, and things move so quickly today, and the science has been ahead of the law for decades. That's the problem. No one ever put a brake on this and said, listen, before we have IVF creating hundreds of thousands of frozen embryos, we should talk about this process. Mm-hmm. Is it right? Is it wrong? Should the law get involved? The law is going to, because we're human beings, the law gets involved in everything. So here's what happens when people say, hey, I lost my frozen embryos. I want money. That's one way the law gets involved. Actually, I just saw on the internet, there's law firms that dedicate a portion of their practice to suing cryogenic labs for these mishaps. They are cryogenic lab malpractice attorneys. So
there's a niche.
Well, there is. And so this whole thing feeds on itself. It feeds on the infertile couples in terms of what they seek because of their infertility and their longing, longing everyone understands to have children, have your own children. And we as a society need to decide, is everyone going to get, and I don't want to suggest that people are selfish in this regard, but this happens in everything, commodities, things we buy. Mm-hmm. Our whole culture, our whole country is like, it's sort of premised on freedom unbounded. I can buy what I want, I can borrow what I want, I can have what I want, and I can have it now.
If I can do it, I want it.
And unless I'm burdening your rights in some fashion, you don't have the right to tell me I can't do that.
Let me ask you a lawyer question here. You say there's firms out here that are devoting a portion to their practice to cryogenic law. This has got to be case law. If in the absence of statutory law, you're going into court and the rules are made based on cases? Because if there is no statutory law, is that what you're saying?
Well, no, it's just like any other. There'll be contracts that are signed.
Right.
So there'll be a contract. We're going to freeze your human embryos. You're going to pay us.
So it's contract law.
And that's part of it. And we're all subject to negligence standards. And it depends on what the contract between these people. Normally, you cannot write out, your negligence. I can't say I'm going to store your antique car in my garage and then not take care of it and say, oh, sorry.
Right, right.
So I don't mean to make a comparison between antique cars and
I get
it. People.
Yeah.
But it's troublesome in the instance I referred to a few moments ago that on the one hand, these couples in this particular lawsuit have treated these frozen embryos as their property. When they're destroyed,
they treat them as their family.
As their unborn children. And I'm not sure what to say about that, but I don't know that that dichotomy has been brought home to the world in that
what
regard.
Changed between property and family? If they were property at the time the contract was entered into, how did they become family now when they're destroyed by negligence?
Well, any hope of them furthering their life as human beings ended. They were killed.
Correct. So they had to be human beings at the point they were viewed as property.
Right. But at the same time, the contract that these folks signed said, we realize at some point, if we don't use them, they're not going to be stored forever and they will be destroyed. So that's the incongruous. The
makes me want to quote the big guy.
Well,
I am God, you are not.
Well, we're definitely playing God in the.
We
in,
sure are.
In the,
Gus, what are you seeing at Dubuque County Right to Life? Are these kinds of things here facing us in Dubuque?
As far as people wanting to participate in IVF? Or?
Well, just challenges, questions, counseling.
Yeah, I think it's one of those things that's not discussed, but it's in people's, it's part of people's lives.
Yeah.
And I think the Alabama case just brought a lot to the surface. They did it really quickly. The news media took off with it with their own headlines. The headlines didn't read the IVF families win lawsuit.
Mm-hmm.
That could have been a realistic headline.
What was the headline?
Well, the headline says Iowa or Alabama Supreme Court
rules against IVF
or causes IVF shutdown. It didn't do any of that. In fact, there hasn't been a trial yet. The trial is going to come now because what Alabama Supreme Court said now, yes, you can go back and have your trial. The lower court judge said there's going to be no trial because these embryos are not children or human beings under the wrongful death statute of the state of Alabama. But these cases are all pointing out, right now everybody has it both ways. In the case of abortion, if there's women, the very fervent pro-abortion people are saying, I know it's a child. They've lost the scientific argument long ago.
Mm-hmm. Right.
This is an unborn human being. Mm-hmm. But it's my human being to either give birth to or destroy. And we as pro-life people say, we don't think that should happen. And in our society, unfortunately, any limitation on people's rights is seen in a negative light right out of the chute.
Right.
Why do you want to restrict me from doing something? I'm not bothering you. You know, this is my life, my being, and so forth. So it's a broader conversation that exceeds the bounds of the time we have here today, but that just means I'll come back. So will Gus. What else do you want to talk about?
Well, I thought Gus had a couple projects over at Dubuque County Right to Life that we haven't talked about yet. Gus, what am I?
Yeah, so outside of the Life Dinner, we're hoping to increase our outreach this year to people on the fence and those who consider themselves to be pro-choice. So maybe, I think it was last year when last time we got together, it's just after our outreach at the Dubuque County Fair. So we'll continue to do that and then also build upon it with 2 to 3 other outreaches this year and hopefully even more next year.
What was the response at the fair? What was that like?
It was really good in the sense of we didn't necessarily tell people that we were pro-life right off the bat. Our intro was, what do you believe and why? Like, we wanted to learn more about where they were coming from. And so that helped our conversation because, especially with those who call themselves pro-choice or didn't know what to believe, that would help our conversation because then we're going against the narrative that they believe about us. Kind of like what I was saying with IVF, that they believe that we hate their kids who have been conceived through IVF. And so that outreach gives us that opportunity to go against the media narrative. It also helps us to have conversations with people who don't have a formed opinion on abortion. And what better way to be the first ones to talk to them about it and give them information and give them good arguments for the pro-life cause. Mm-hmm. And people of all ages, and especially the young people really took to what we call the pull table, participating in our pull table, which is our key generation to reach.
Mm-hmm. So that was the Dubuque County Fair. That's usually, what, the fourth week in July? You going back this year?
Yeah, and we hope to have even more people helping us out. And so we'll also be doing trainings for the Equip for Life course to learn how to have better dialogues with people. And also another thing that we're also looking into, as more states ramp up, as more neighboring states ramp up their efforts to push assisted suicide, we're also looking at increasing our efforts to educate people on the harms and dangers of that.
Yeah, one of the big ones is death.
Mm-hmm.
Holy cow. So what states surrounding Iowa are pushing that? Are we surrounded, Art?
Well, every state has, you mean in terms of euthanasia, assisted suicide?
Yeah.
I'm fairly confident it's been introduced again this year. It's going nowhere because of the pro-life Republican majority in the Iowa State House. And it's been offered in just about every state in the country.
Really?
And Oregon, Washington, some of those states already have it. So,
But Minnesota, Illinois have some
version of it.
Yeah, version, and some, obviously there's a decent amount of Democrats that support it.
What's the narrative? How does it gain traction?
Self-determination, and no one wants to suffer. And what they leave out of the debate is, you know, they can control pain. We can control pain at the end of death.
Yeah.
And no one wants to see their loved ones suffer. The problem is, if you give physicians the right to assist in killing people, then your physician is doing something, first of all, it goes against the Hippocratic Oath to do no harm. And then secondly, over time, it normalizes the rationality of wanting to die. So someone might say, well, I don't care if you want to go kill yourself, if you think that's rational. And over time, if more people think that's rational, at some point in time, a family that says, I want to end Art's suffering in his later days, he's just suffering.
Mm-hmm.
And so let's give him a shot because he's going to die anyway. Well, over time, the people that don't have loved ones around them at the end of the nursing home hall,
right,
who are sitting there, can't watch TV, blind in both eyes, hard of hearing, who speaks for them? you know, the National Associations for Disabled People are almost uniformly against physician-assisted suicide for that reason. That is, people will start to judge and put forth for someone else their idea of when they should die. So we have to get comfortable with the dying process. Hospice has helped do that to a certain extent by saying the dying process is a dying process. Their philosophy is live until you die.
Yes.
So, you know, as people, why be afraid of death? And the people that want to, there's people out there say, well, why, just like this other thing we're talking about, rights expanding, why do you have the right to stop me if I want to kill myself? Well, the short version of the answer to that is, I don't, but I don't need to legalize a doctor helping you.
Gus, when did euthanasia start to creep into the awareness of Dubuque County right to life? It doesn't seem like that's been something I've heard in Dubuque in recent years. How long has this been around?
It's in our original charter from 1986.
Really?
Yeah, oh sure. Abortion, infanticide, and euthanasia.
I think it's been in the charter, but one of the things is with abortion so prevalent in our culture and in our society that we focused on that one for a long time.
But we have a whole...
When did it become a tangible topic that we had to talk about it? I mean,
I've done programs with one of Gus's predecessors out in the community numerous times on euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide. And others have too, not just me. So we have a whole program that we
But it just seems to be front and center now, mm-hmm. Colleen, doesn't it?
Yeah, I wonder if the Terry Schiavo case maybe really brought it to the forefront, even though it was going on before then.
How many years ago has
then.
That been going on now?
Gosh.
That was in 2005.
Okay.
20 years ago.
Mm-hmm. But of course, it was going on before that. But that one seemed to really get national attention. But it's been around a long time.
You want to end on a good note?
Yes.
We need something.
Yes.
You got 2 minutes of goodness.
All right, Gus, you run it from page 9 of our newsletter. Tell them.
Why don't you tell them a little bit of the background of the story, and then I can tell them about what the initiative that we're doing.
Okay. Right, every Thursday, people from Dubuque County Right to Life and from Dubuque go down to join the pro-life folks in Johnson County at the Emma Goldman Abortion Clinic because they do abortions on Thursday. We sidewalk counsel and offer free help and information to the victims going in there to tell them that there's help available for every reason that's driving them there. Last October, we had a couple that went to Emma Goldman to get the abortion pills, prayed and thought about it for a week, and came back a week later and said, we're not going to do this. So several of us met with them, found out what their needs were. They were there because of finances. So since then, we've helped them pay 4 or 5 months of rent, guided them to a doctor, got them transportation to the doctor, and just enveloped them with love. And Dubuque County Right to Life has supported them in some rental payments, and we know our membership would want us to do that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like $500 a month. We're not paying every month, and this couple is in May won't need them anymore. Johnson County Right to Life helped in several of the payments, so we're kind of splitting it with them. So then, Gus, what have we kind of, with this happening and us wanting to offer that help, we're not a social service agency, we're an educational organization, but we know our members would want to support this effort, so what do we do?
Yeah, so we created an initiative where we'll earmark some funds that people donate towards this specific purpose to help moms and families in need who don't necessarily qualify for whatever social services exist. Because I think some people, they don't qualify for example, like if you already had your kids and you couldn't support your two-year-old or whatever, well then the pregnancy resource center wouldn't necessarily be the place to go. So there's this little niche that just people come that need help that are within this small niche. And that's the same with this family. They didn't necessarily qualify for all the other social help that was out there. And so that's why we were able to step in. So
how fast were you able to turn around assistance here from the
1 hour? We met with
within
them.
Within 1 hour.
We met with them, and I said, this is on a Thursday morning, 11 o'clock, back October. He said, in 1 hour, you're going to get a call from someone who's going to say, Art told me to call. And it could have been anyone, but I happened to be there that day. Within an hour, we had a pro-life crisis pregnancy resource center in southwest Iowa contact them. It was a nurse. We got a doctor. She hadn't had this. The mom was 6 weeks pregnant, got her first prenatal visit set up, didn't have transportation. We got that set up through another Right to Life organization down in that area. And we're off and running. The rental needs everything. And if you want to read about this, it's on page 9 of the excellent newsletter Gus has put together for March. And they sent a little thank you note there.
We're running out of time. How do we get this newsletter in people's hands if they don't have it, Gus?
Yes, they can call our office, 563-556-5960, or email us at dcrtl@dcrtl.org.
And hit that Mark Hawk dinner coming up here one more time. Get that punched up,
so that's
please.
On April 4th. April 4th, Thursday. It's a Thursday this year, April 4th, at 5 p.m. at the Grand River Center. You need to RSVP. And, yeah, it will be an awesome evening. Looking forward to it.
And tell your listeners if they have want information on any of the things we've talked about or more expansive educational materials on it, call Gus, Augustine Payne, our wonderful executive director at Dubuque County Right to Life. We also have Shauna Peterson there, our outreach director. Laura Dalahide is in helping. Someone will be there to answer their questions and help them get information.
And for those of you who think Art Gilloon doesn't move as fast as he used to, you've just heard it. He got money to that woman and her family in 60 minutes. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Glory be
to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Chatter's brought to you by Hot Works. Our guests are Art Gilloon, Augustine Payne, and Dubuque County Right to Life. Colleen, we'll see you next week.
See you next week.
We love you.